Thanks, Anna, for the introduction. So yeah, luckily we are back to sea ice. And so yeah, I will give this presentation is basically an overview about snow on sea ice, which is, as you have heard in the presentations on Tuesday, a very important property of the sea ice surface, because it characterizes the sea ice surface substantially, but it's also needed for the computation of sea ice thickness from altimetry and remote sensing. Here we go. So just a brief outline. I start with a short introduction and the impact of the snow and why is it important. Then like some characteristics of the snow cover, because it's a very complex system. Then an overview about like remote sensing of snow, but also climatologies and other products that are available. Then I will give an overview about like some validation data. So what do we have actually to validate remote sensing snow depth products, but also climatologies. And so finally, there's a chapter about the impact of the snow on sea ice thickness retrieval, so which is directly linked to what we heard on Wednesday. So yeah, starting with the introduction. So this is just like a nice picture of the Earth snow coverage of the Earth from NASA, and you see substantially high area of the Earth of the north and southern hemisphere are covered with snow. During March, and along with this, like snow and sea ice are together, and also each of them are the most variable surface shapes we have on Earth. So why is snow? Why do we care about the snow on the sea ice? So these are just like some aspects of the snow. So one important thing is it's a very good insulator between the ocean and the atmosphere. So it's very important for the heat flux between the ocean and the atmosphere. It's a much better insulator than sea ice, for example. Another very important point is the high albedo, and we will give a short example on the next slide. It's a very important input for fresh water, because, for example, for the northern hemisphere, snow is melting completely during summer. And another aspect, yeah, as I already mentioned, so it's very important for the freeboard to thickness conversion if you work with radar altimetry data, but also laser altimetry data, because you have to convert freeboard into thickness, and therefore you have to assume the snow depth. Yeah, another point, rather practical, is it's very important for marine maritime operations. So it's not only the sea ice which is an obstacle for maritime observations. It's also the snow, and if you have a substantial snow layer, it can really produce much more friction to the ship, and by a factor of up to more than 50% compared to a bare ice cover. And yeah, finally, it's also very important for the biology. So especially for algae, I just put an iceberg here because I thought it looks nicer. So, but it's very important for microalgae, for example, and it's a common habitat for algae. And so yeah, as I said, it's it's very important for the Earth's energy budget. So so I put some numbers here. It's not so important, but what is important, like the thermal conductivity from snow to sea ice, it's tenfold. So it's a factor of 10 higher for sea ice. So you see that snow is a really good insulator. And for the albedo, you have a fourfold energy entry if you have no snow. So you have a much higher albedo if you have a snow cover. It's already decreased if the snow is wet. So for the Earth's energy budget, the snow is very important. So yeah, this is just like a sketch of how the snow characterized the sea ice cover. So for the Arctic during winter, snow is accumulating on the sea ice, then it melts completely during summer, and then those typical melt ponds are forming. So yeah, then with beginning of September or mid of September in autumn, like snow starts accumulating again. And so what can happen here if snow starts accumulating on thin ice? It can it depresses the ice cover below the water level, and then you can have like this typical flooding. So the ice cover, the ice surface is flooded, and you have then wet snow. And then you have like very complex processes within the snow cover. So you can have a forming of a snow ice where the snow is flooded, and when it's then freezing again, then this slush is freezing. And then you can also, like, this is like rather typical for the Antarctic. I will come to that later. Then if you have melting during the summer, like the snow is getting wet on the base and then can refreeze again. So then you can have like such superimposed ice formation. So we will see this later, and it's very important for remote sensing processing and aspects. So yes, let's see what are the characteristics of the snow. So it all starts with these guys, with snowflakes falling down as precipitation. So actually, in contrast to sea ice, for sea ice you just need like temperatures below freezing, and then the water is freezing. So it's pretty simple. But for snow, you need actually three things. You need precipitation. You need the temperature below freezing, and you need an ice cover, because otherwise it's just falling into the water. So this is difference to sea ice. And then if you have a lot of these snow flakes and precipitation falling down and accumulating over sea ice, and it looks like that. This is an ice covered snow covered sea ice in, I think it's September in 2015 when we went with Polarstern to the Arctic. And yeah, you already see some typical features. So these are like features of the ice cover, like ridged ice flows. And so then when snow is like accumulating, you also like have like wind blowing, and then so snow starts to accumulate close to the ridges, and it's a really dynamic process. Which then forms the snow depth distribution. What are the general characteristics of snow? So you already seen like the snowflakes. It's what you initially have, but then what's really important is the metamorphism. So the snowflakes, they don't So they change, so they can be destroyed through the wind. So they can like change to small grains, and then you have like different grain types, actually. So you can have, yeah, this new and recent snow, which is like really fluffy. Then you have can have this fine grain snow if you have like wind blowing. Then so snowflakes are just colliding and then like are like forming this fine grain snow. Then you can have a wind slab. So when this fine grain snow is accumulating, you can have like this typical, it's rather like concrete snow. So it's very, it's very stable. So it's very nice also to build igloos actually. And another type is like the faceted grains and death ore, which is like, which is built if you have like temperature gradients within your snow layer, then like due to vapor, which is like rising, you can have like like new crystals build within the snow cover, and therefore build this faceted grains. Finally, then you can also have the icy layers. When you have partial melting, then like icy layers within the snow cover form. And yeah, when after the melt onset, you can also have like damp and wet snow, and finally slush. So yeah, these are some examples of how these grains look like. So these are typical melt grains, which like form such clusters and look rather smooth, and they have this depth ore, which can make really nice structures. And this like wind slab and new recent snow. So what's actually the difference between Antarctic and Arctic? So we will just go briefly through it. So in the Arctic, you have actually no snow, usually no snow in summer. So it's melting completely during summer. So it's completely different in the Antarctic. It's not melting completely, it persists through the summer. As I already mentioned, so you can have icy layers and superimposed ice and rather snow ice because you have much more flooding in the Antarctic. Whereas in the Arctic, you have the typical melt pond forming during the summer when snow is melting. And yeah, I'm not going too much in, I think you know, like difference in geography and meteorology. So actually this is a nice picture of an ice flow which is just turning, and you kind of see that here you have like the snow cover, and then you have like the superimposed ice here, so that's an icy layer. And then you have like a kind of gap layer here, and then there's another ice layer. So this is a typical ice flow you can find in the Antarctic. Just like briefly again, like the forming of snow ice in the Antarctic. So as I said, so if you have like a substantial snow load over thin ice, then the ice cover is depressed below the water level. And if it's then refreezing, you have the snow ice, which contributes to the ice mass balance. These are like seasonal backscatter over the Arctic and the Antarctic. And it's from ERS Scatterometer, and so it's very interesting. So these cycles you see here, these annual cycles, you see here you have this like steep decrease in the Arctic, which is usually here happening in summer when snow melts. So you have like the wet surface, so you have a decrease of backscatter, so you have much more absorption. Whereas in the Antarctic, it's quite interesting. You have this like this peaks here, the steep increases in summer. So it's rather like January, February, because it's southern hemisphere. And so you have the steep increases, and that's because of the superimposed ice. Because when superimposed ice is building, it kind of adds surface roughness to the ice surface. And this really impacts the backscatter signature you finally derive. So the formation of superimposed ice. This is what you've seen before. This is mostly counting for the Antarctic. When you have wet snow in summer, it's not melting completely as in the Arctic, and the melting processes are usually much slower. And so then you have like this diurnal melt and refreezing. So you have superbuilding superimposed ice here, and then you can also get this gap layers in between due to like this terminal processes, which then also contribute to the ice mass balance. And so this is an example from an ice core. And you can nicely see here, so this is the wet snow, the melted snow. And here you have such a gap layer. So this is a superimposed ice. And here you have the second ice ice layer. Okay, so now we've seen some characteristics of snow on sea ice from the Arctic and the Antarctic. What do we have in terms of remote sensing products, and how can we observe the processes of the snow and also the properties like snow depth and density? So one big problem in observing snow is to get actually the seasonality. Because you have lots of changes due to snow drift, which depends on the meteorology. You have lots of metamorphism within the snow layer, which is spatially very variable. And so what do we have? We have snow climatologies, as you will see later, which describe density and snow depth and snow water equivalent of the snow of the snow cover, but this only counts for the Arctic, where we have the warring climatology, which is introduces on the next slide. We have few multi-seasonal studies, but some drift experiments in the Arctic, but not so much in the Antarctic. Passive microwave snow depth products. We have from both hemisphere. Then there are like some ship-based observation data sets. These are the programs. So there's ESSIS and ESPECT. So ESSIS is still like in, it just started, I think. And ESPECT, it's existing for quite some time already. And so it's based on ship observations. So whenever like icebreakers or any other ship is going to the Arctic or Antarctic, like from the bridge, they are made observations by people, and they observe so the ice cover, but also the snow cover, and kind of estimate the snow depth, for example, and also the properties of the snow. But it's of course rather a guess than a proper measurement, but. At least it gives you like an idea of what's the state of the ice and snow cover. So yeah, and just introducing here, I put some always some blue boxes on the slides, which give you the link to the data sets if you're looking for it, if you have the slides. I was promising to introduce warring climatology. So this is a climatology, the snow depth climatology for November till April, so during the winter season in the Arctic. And you see, it's quite old already. it was gathered from Soviet drifting stations from the 50s to the early 90s. And so, yeah, this is like just an example of such a drifting station. So they do like validation lines on the sea ice, measuring ice properties, but also snow depth and density. And this has been done here. So this is work gathered by Steve Warren in 1999, and he actually did this climatology, and it's actually great work because it was not that easy to gather like this all this like data, partly like handwritten in notebooks from the Soviets. And so he gathered all the data and did a kind of 2D fit. And here, so these numbers telling you like how many measurements you find in these grid cells. And then there were also like airborne in situ measurements, airborne-based measurements, which you also find here. So he gathered the data and did a climatology, and you finally get snow depth, monthly snow depth product for the Arctic. Based on such in situ measurements. What you can do then is you can compare these climatology values from Steve Warren with recent measurements of snow depth. And we already heard about like Operation Ice Bridge. So they do annually measurements of also like sea ice freeboard and so on, but also they have a snow radar, so they measure snow thickness. And so you can compare how snow depth actually has changed compared to the 50s and up to the early 90s. So, and these are the results. So this is the 2D fit of all ice bridge measurements from 2009 to 2013. And this is a Warren climatology. And you already see that you have like much more, like much higher snow depth than we have now. So this has like several reasons, because we have first, we have much less multi-year ice nowadays. So, so there is like on first year ice, snow can only start to accumulating when ice grows or when ice starts to grow. Whereas on first year on multi-year ice, it's already there. So as soon as snow is falling, it can accumulate. And second thing is that the melting degree days, they start to increase due to the climate change. So we have less snow or we have less precipitation, which comes as snow, actually. So these are the reasons why we have like a decrease of the snow depth compared to 20, 30, 40 years ago. And so this is finally the difference, and you see that there's quite a substantial difference of about 20 centimeter up to 20 centimeter. So what you do then is, if you want to have a recent climatology, you can kind of adjust the Warren climatology by taking into account that you have a loss of multi-year ice. So if you look at the Operation Ice Bridge measurements, you find like a value of more or less 50% decrease of snow depth over first year ice compared to multi-year ice. So what you basically do is you just multiply the snow depth over first year ice with a factor of 0.5 and get this modified climatology, which is mostly used nowadays still to retrieve sea ice thickness. So you use it for the freeboard to thickness conversion. Yeah, so something else you can measure with passive microwave satellite observations is the snow melt or the onset of snow melt. And this is because of, so for example, with AMSAR-E, which is, has a multi, which is multi-frequency passive microwaves, you can retrieve like signals from the 19 gigahertz and the 37 gigahertz, which have like different penetration depth. And so you have like a sensitivity rather from the snow surface and but also like from the snow volume. And so with these sensitivities, you can kind of observe when the snow starts melting. And so one possibility is to look at the brightness temperature directly, which gives you such signals. So this is just observation of one point, one location in the Antarctic. And yeah, you see here like this blue curve, it's the brightness temperature. And you have to take care about the sea ice concentration because yeah, it doesn't really count for the brightness temperature. But if you calculate the cross-polarized ratio, which is just the ratio between 19 and 37 gigahertz, which gives you so which actually like which decreases if you have like low sea ice concentration, and if it's increasing or if it's above one, so this ratio is above one, telling you that the snow starts melting, and you see the signals here, so you can then like detect the onset of the melting. So they are like, this is just like a sketch of how you can like derive the characteristic snow melt type. So as shown, you can just use the diurnal variation in brightness temperature, which gives you actually two types of distribution. So and why the two types? So you have multimodal, which just means that you have like semi-diurnal signals. So because you have like this freezing, melt-freezing cycles in the Antarctic. So that's why you get like two modes here. So the second mode is the melting, the first is the freezing. And that's how you can detect when this cycles with melting, freezing starts. And with a cross polarized ratio, you can actually like detect the continuous snow melt onset, which usually is later than the cycles with the surface melt onset. And so yeah, here you have like this is a temporary snow melt onset, so where you have like freezing and melting during the day, and this is a continuous snow melt onset where you have just melting basically, which is yeah, as you can see, a bit later than the temporary snow melt onset, and you see it's basically a latitudinal dependence. So yeah, so you can detect like the snow melt onset, but you can also measure the snow depth with passive microwave. So in this case, with AMSAR-E, and it's very similar. So you take the difference between both frequencies, between 19 and 37, which give you the sensitivity to the snow depth, and then you fit. Then you fit this ratio to in situ measurements to get the snow depth. So it's basically just a linear fit. And what you get then is the snow depth. So you can apply it for the Arctic and for the Antarctic. It doesn't work over multi-year ice due to the surface roughness, basically. And you see quite nice here, like the gradients, and you see you have much more like much more snow here over the in the Weddell Sea in the Antarctic of up to like 50-60 centimeters. And yeah, so these data are derived from NSIDC, which provide a really nice database for all kinds of sea ice data from remote sensing data from sea ice. So how to validate these data? So I already showed you that in the Antarctic we have these aspect data sets which are like derived from ship-based observations of the snow depth, and so this is an example of a comparison between the satellite derived snow depth and the aspect data. And you see that like AMSAR-E is doing quite well. If you have like snow depths like 10, 15 centimeters, but then it's like here it's underestimating the snow. It's underestimating the snow depth, especially in East Antarctica, which is associated to higher surface roughness there. It doesn't work in any case, and it's still not very well validated actually. So this is some future work that has to be done. So another method to derive snow depth from remote sensing is with SMOS, which is Soil Moisture and Ocean Salinity satellite mission, just started in 2010. It's still active, and it measures surface emissivity in L band. So it's 1.5 gigahertz. So it does penetrate even the sea ice actually. So it's rather low frequency. And so why can you use it? So you can use it over thick ice. So it's complementary to the AMSAR-E product, which usually doesn't work very well over multi-year ice. So in contrast, SMOS snow depth product works better, or just works over multi-year ice, because you see quite nice here the sensitivity to of the snow thickness to the brightness temperature. Because if you have just thin ice, then it very depends on the thin ice how high your brightness temperature is. So if you have like the thick ice, it's much more sensitive only to the snow cover. So you use this sensitivity to the snow depth to calculate your snow depth from the brightness temperature over thick ice. And but it only works when you have really like cold temperatures. So you see here the sensitivities again. So the sensitivity is much better if you have like temperatures below or equal to minus 30 degrees. The higher the temperature, the worse the sensitivity. Again, some validation measurements. So this is for the Arctic, and so here it's compared to ice bridge measurements, snow radar measurements, and again, you see quite some correlation for for lower snow thickness, but then again, it doesn't fit so well for the thick snow. So yeah, there's still some work to do. And so yeah, what you can also do is model simulations. So just like briefly put this equation here and the contributions of different processes. I don't want to go into detail here. So just like, okay, you have to take the snowfall rate. So you use reanalysis data, error interim in this case, where you get the precipitation. And then you have like sources of snow, so sources of accumulation, but then you also have like sinks, like loss due to heat transfer between ocean and atmosphere, and loss by flooding and by advection. So yeah, I don't want to go into detail here, but another comparison to observational data, again to IceBridge. So there's just one track here which starts in first year ice and then goes here into multi-year ice. And so this is the transect here and the comparison between Operation IceBridge, which is the red, and the model data, which is the blue. So you see quite nice that the model gets a gradient of the snow. But still, you have some systematic errors or uncertainties here. So it's always a question. So because you mostly rely also on the reanalysis data, and so how much can you rely on the data in the Central Arctic when you have from the reanalysis data in the Central Arctic when you have actual data only at the coast? So it's a question. So now to the validation. So if you're going to get snow depth and density and the properties, so the best thing you can do, you go in the field and you measure by hand the snow depth. It's the most accurate measurement you can get. But of course, it doesn't work for the entire Arctic unless you hire like 100,000 of students or so. But you can contribute quite some important information. So you can do snow pits and evaluate the stratigraphy of the snow. You can do surveys with an instrument called MagnaProbe, which is very nice, and gather the snow thickness. So this is an example of some grids we did on the cruise last year in 2015 in the Arctic in September. And it gives you some snow depth distribution here. Another possibility is airborne. And again, here an example of Operation IceBridge, because they carry usually a snow radar, and you get like a really impressive coverage of the Western Arctic. And they have a very nice web page where you can really like interactively choose each track and get all the information of the data. So that's very nice. So if you work with this data, you can get such nice like snow depth distributions in the Western Arctic, and so they're really widely used for the validation of snow depth products, passive microwave, but also climatologies or others. What else? So. Something which is still rising, I think, it's this autonomous station, so buoys. So there are like basically two types, I think, which measure the snow depth, which is the ice mass balance buoys, which also like measure ice thickness and thermal conductivity. And snow buoys, which only measure snow depth. So they typically have these echo sounders here and just like measure the range to the surface. So when snow accumulates, this alters the measured range. And so you get your a time series of snow accumulation, which looks really nice and is really helpful for some to some aspects. But on the other hand, it's just a point measurements, and therefore you have to be aware, and you always have to think about how much it represents, like the vicinity of or other ice flows in the vicinity, because you can have just like bad luck, and there's just like a, I don't know, a snow dune just like next to the buoy, and this would completely, alter your representation for the snow depth on that flow. But yeah, here you see some tracks. So there are different archives where you can gather such buoy data. So this is an example from the sea ice portal, and there you can like get like the buoys from the Arctic and the Antarctic, and here are some more archives. So there are archives, especially for the Arctic and then also for the Antarctic, from Krell as well. So finally, we come to the impact of the snow on sea ice thickness retrievals. And so here again, picture of the snow layer, and it's probably hard to see here on that screen, but there are some internal layers here in the snow cover, which probably formed because of melting and refreezing during the snow accumulation. And so these icy layers then, of course, impact the properties and the dielectric properties of the snow, which is important for K-U-band radar altimetry, for example. So just like, again, the principle of Kreiser 2 measuring sea ice freeboard, which we've already seen on Wednesday. So what you usually want to get is the ice freeboard, the height of the ice surface above the water level. And if you have a snow cover, so usually if you have, so this is what we assume, if you have cold and dry snow, it penetrates through the snow, and you sense the ice cover with your radar. But if you have like snow metamorphism and icy layers within your snow, this could really alter your range retrieval, and this could also like impact the main scattering horizon of the radar return. So another aspect is I already said it. So another aspect is the snow depth. It's also a key parameter for the conversion into thickness. So I already said it in the introduction that you need the snow depth to convert freeboard into thickness. And so I also said that still we use the Warren climatology as a guess for the snow depth to calculate the sea ice thickness, and this is like a comparison of in situ measurements we did last summer with Polar Stern, and we did lots of snow grids during the cruise, and this is a comparison with the Warren climatology in September, end of September, and we had a lot of precipitation, a lot of snow, so this is over multi-year ice then,
but we see that we had much more snow than it's shown by the climatologies. Differences up to 10 centimeters, which is quite substantial. And this shows that the Warren climatology doesn't account for the interannual variability, because you just you get a guess for each month, but you totally miss an interannual variability, which is there, as these measurements show. So what you have to do then is, so if you don't have this interannual variability in your snow depth product you use, you have to estimate the uncertainties you introduce. So fortunately, these uncertainties of the snow depth due to the interannual variability are given in the Warren climatology or in the paper. And so if you translate it then into uncertainties in the derived CI thickness, you get such patterns here. So this is the variability of the interannual variability of snow depth. And so you get like errors of 20, 25 centimeters in CI thickness. But then, of course, you have other sources of uncertainties. And these are just a few. You have much more if you also consider the other density values. But just considering snow here, of course, snow density also introduced some uncertainty. Then, because you separate between multi and first year ice, you have some uncertainty due to the uncertainty in the ice type product. And then you also have some uncertainties due to the 2D fit, because the climatology is a 2D fit, which also like comes with a certain uncertainty. So yeah, again, so this is like the second way the snow can impact your thickness retrieval is due to like volume scattering and changes in the surface roughness due to the snow layer. And there are some recent studies which show the impact of the snow layer due to volume and volume scattering in the snow. So this is one study done in 2010 and 2011, so for the Arctic and also for the Antarctic. This is from the Arctic, from Rosie Willett. And so they did validation measurements over, in this case, it's over multi-year ice in the Arctic, from Alert, I think, in this case. And so they flew with Aziras, which is an airborne simulator of CryoSat. It has the same radar altimeter as CryoSat. So they did like validation lines across the multi-year ice. And on the ground, they installed some corner reflectors, which gives you like a reference of your radar return. And this is what you see here. Like the CR are the corner reflectors, and these peaks are the return power of your radar altimeter. And then of course, you from the ground you have the reference. You know where is your snow surface, and you know where is your ice surface. So you can reference your radar returns, and so. What you see here, so this is an example from 2006, and I have to say here that the air temperatures were pretty high. They were up to -4 degrees. So this can already like alter the properties of the snow, and as you see here, like many returns are closer to the snow surface than to the ice surface. You have other validation lines. They also did some validation lines where you had like much lower temperatures, and you could see that then you have like the radar returns rather close to the ice surface. So it depends really on the properties of the snow, and also like if you see, if you look at cries that freeboard retrievals in end of April or in May when snow starts getting wet due to melting, you can see like if you look at the gridded products, they don't have a plot here, but then you can really see the orbit patterns because the main scattering horizons shifted to the snow surface, and this you can see then really in the gridded product. So another experiment which has been conducted is over fast ice in the McMurdo Sound in Antarctica. They did some validation lines also here below Kreiset 2 tracks. And so what is really nice, they did it over fast ice, and they had a line which was covered by a thin snow layer, just 7 centimeters, and a snow layer of about 20 centimeters, so much thicker. And so what we did then is we took all the waveforms over the validation line, so all Kreiset 2 waveforms over the thin snow layer and over the thick snow layer, and stacked it. And so the gray, the dotted gray waveform is the stacked waveform over the thin snow, and the black solid is stacked over the thick snow. And you really see, you have, we heard it on Wednesday, you see here the difference in the tail, which is due to the volume scattering. But you also see you have a difference if you look really close here. You have a difference in the leading edge. It's more wider for the thicker snow layer. So which can be also like associated with volume scattering and also surface roughness. But again, it's really hard to quantify these effects because at some point the resolution of the waveforms, I mean the resolution is, the vertical resolution is it's 23 centimeters or so. So and so it's very hard to resolve these differences here in the at the leading edge. So another experiment we did, so we looked at ice mass balance buoys, which measure snow depth as well, and compared it to Kreiset 2 measurements in the vicinity, so within a radius of 50 kilometers, what you see here. So we gathered just like waveforms in within the circles every 2 days, and compared the freeboard we got from the Kreiset 2 measurements with the freeboard and the ice thickness and the snow depth from the ice mass balance buoys. So and these are the results. So to explain, the black line is the ice surface elevation of the buoys. So you see here, like this is September, so it's always like the winter season, September to May, for every plot. So these are 4 buoys, and so black is the surface elevation, the ice surface elevation, the gray is the snow surface elevation, and red, green, and blue are Kreiset 2 freeboard retrievals calculated with different thresholds. That's why you have like different elevations. But it's not so important because they all show like similar trends. And what's now interesting is not to compare like the absolute values, but just compare the trends. And you see in many cases when snow starts to accumulate, the ice freeboard is depressed because of the load of the snow. And at the same time, you would expect also from Kreiset measurements that the freeboard starts or is decreasing, but it's actually increasing, and the trend is rather similar to the trend of the snow surface. So you really have some correlation here between accumulation of snow and the derived freeboard from Kreiser 2, which gives us indication that the Kreiser 2 range retrieval is impacted by snow accumulation. So yeah, so these are our this is where our conclusions that we find like negative trends for the IMB ice freeboard, while the snow freeboard gives us positive trends because it's accumulated, because the snow accumulates, whereas simultaneously we observed only positive trends for coincident Kreiser 2 radar freeboard. So we have rather correlation with the snow freeboard rather than with the ice freeboard. Of course, I mean, also this study has some weak points, and one weak point is that so you look at buoy measurements, which are point measurements, so you never really know how are the ice dynamics in the vicinity of the buoys within this 50 kilometers. So these are always like weak points. I mean, this is why we use many buoys, but still you have some uncertainties due to the lack of representation in the vicinity of the buoys. So yeah, to give an outlook, what can we work on in terms of snow and sea ice? I think we still need a systematic validation of current snow depth products. So we have this passive microwave snow depth products from AMSAR-E, but also from L-band, from SMOS. But still, there are not so many studies on how representative are such snow depth products. That's actually also why the Warren climatology is still used in many cases for deriving sea ice thickness from radar altimetry. What is also needed is more systematic seasonal in-situ measurements of snow and snow properties in the Arctic, but also in the Antarctic. So this means mostly stratigraphy, density, but also surface roughness to more characterize the distribution, the spatial distribution of the Antarctic and Arctic snow cover. Another point is, improving the relevant processes and models. So you can also model snow depth, of course, but it really depends on what kind of input data you have, like how representative are, for example, the era interim reanalysis precipitation data. So these are points which we also have to study. Then of course you can also like improve the passive microwave product itself. So you can always improve algorithms. I mean, it counts actually for everything. What you can also do, and there are already quite some efforts, is an optimal interpolation approach of different snow depth data sets. So something similar like the Warren climatology, but using ice bridge data, snow buoy data, and other in-situ measurements to kind of get a more representative climatology of the recent years. Which would kind of improve also the thickness products. But last thing is to get like the uncertainties and the impact of the snow volume on Ku-band radar thickness retrievals, one can also try to do model studies
like building forward models, simulate Kreiser 2 measurements over snow cover, and try to study the impacts of different snow properties. But again, this is a really like challenging topic, because therefore you also need realistic estimates of snow density, of the stratigraphy. And here we come actually back to this point, so that we really need more systematic measurements of the snow properties. So that's it actually, and it I think it should show that we really had to care more about snow, and there were already a lot of effort in deriving CI thickness from remote sending, but not that much in terms of snow. So one could say that snow is the new CI thickness, because it's getting more and more important. It has some really important aspects for like energy budget, for the albedo, but also for deriving CI thickness from altimetry. So therefore, we should really take care about it. That's it. Thanks.